First Sunday of the month, our lesson will be on one of our favorite songs. Now, this particular song is from Tara Middleton. Tara had been diagnosed with cancer. She was 48 years old. That clearly is a message that none of us want to hear from a doctor. We know that there are lots of cure rates, different types of cancer have a good cure rate, but still, although not experienced it personally, I imagine it makes your heart race, your pulse pound, and your palms get sweaty. You start thinking about all the bad things that could be happening. If that wasn't enough, a year later, as you know, Jeff, her husband, passed away. So on top of having to deal with cancer, she got the news that she was now a young widow. And when that kind of thing happens to you, where do you go? What do you do? What happens to your faith? Even as a Christian, it is hard to sit back and say, well, okay, that's fine. That's life. Well, that doesn't come easy, does it? And on top of experiencing bad things yourself, you look around at others and you see that others who are not Christians, make no claim to be Christian, have a happy marriage, strong marriage, good family, happy family, close-knit family. Seems like everything is going well with them and nothing is going well with you. And you say, well, I'm a Christian. Why isn't God doing that for me? And it's easy to do that. It's easy to look around in this physical life and say, why isn't God doing more for me? We look around at the prosperity of the wicked. Even as we, being righteous as we can be, experience bad times. And that's what motivates the author of this song, farther along, tempted and tried, we're all made to wonder, why it should be. And after the song, I want us to look at Psalm 73. So if you would, turn in your Bible to Psalm 73. If you're using the Bible in the pew, it's page 485. Psalm 73 was written by a singer during the times of David and King Solomon. He was a leader of the Levites and singing praises to God. Asaph is his name. And so Asaph is, as far as we know, not a lot written about him, but Asaph, as far as we know, is a strong, dedicated follower of God. But when he writes Psalm 73, he is going through the same feelings, the same emotions, the same tests of faith that Tara has gone through, that the author of this song has gone through. Where do we go when our faith is tested, when we're tempted and tried? Let us sing this song together, Brother Doug Leaches.
Tempted and tried. Yeah.
trained out to the Indian territories, and he had to be separated from his wife, who was pregnant with their first child. And he says, tempted and tried, where all they will wander, why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others, notice, while there are others living about us, never molested, though we walk. When death has come and taken our loved ones and leaves our home so lonely and drear, then do we wonder why others prosper, even as they live wickedly year after year. Look at Psalm 73 now and verse 1. Asaph says, surely God is good to Israel, to those who have an upright heart. Asaph, right now, this first verse, is a believer. Asaph understands the nature of God, as we talked about last Sunday. The very first point of the lesson last Sunday, God is love. And here Asaph begins by saying, I know, I understand, I have faith in, I have confidence in the idea that God is good. And not just good, but he says he is good to those who are of a pure heart. Now, Asaph uses the word heart some half a dozen times in this song, because that is where the battle takes place. The battle takes place in our heart. Am I going to let the prosperity of the wicked knock me off my feet? Am I going to let the prosperity of the wicked shake my foundation? Or am I going to remind myself in my heart that God is good? I don't understand. I don't know where life is going. I don't know where life is headed. But I know that God is good. And here is the problem that Asaph has in verse 2. Asaph knows that God is good, and yet Asaph doubts. As he looks around, he says, but as for me, my feet came close to stumbling. My steps had almost slipped. Why? Because he says in verse 3, I saw the prosperity of the wicked, and I was envious of the arrogant. You see, this feeling that we have sometimes, even if we have been Christians for years and years and years, Asaph had this problem thousands of years ago. You look around and you see the prosperity of the wicked, how things are going great with them, and you think, why am I trying to do right? Why am I trying to live this way when they're the ones having good things happen to them? And Asaph says, this made my feet slip. This made my path slippery, and it becomes a doubter. Tara wrote several paragraphs for me to explain why this is her favorite song. And Tara says, many simple people get rewards here on earth. They are very visible to us. And how true that is when we look around and see the prosperity of the wicked. In fact, look at verses 4 through 9 and how the psalmist describes the wicked in his life. He says there's no pains in their death. Their body is fat. That is, they have lots of blessings. You know, they eat well, they have lots of blessings. They're not in trouble as other men, nor are they plagued like mankind. Bad things don't happen to them. And their pride is their necklace, and violence is their garment that they wear. That's why they're wicked. He says their eyes bulge from fat, and the imaginations of their heart run riot, and they mock and wickedly speak of oppression. And they speak from on high. That is, they act like they're in charge of everything. They act like they're untouchable. They put themselves in an ivory tower, we might say today. And in verse 9, he says, they've set their mouths against the heavens and their tongue parades through the earth. In other words, they speak against God. Here are you trying to be faithful to God, and I'm suffering, and there they are speaking evil against God, and they're prospering. And Asaph becomes a wrestler, we might say, because he is having to try to reconcile those two concepts. How can God be good and bless those who are faithful to him, but then they suffer? And on the other hand, there's people over here who don't care about God. They don't follow God. In fact, they curse God and they blaspheme God. And things are going well with them. And they never seem to have any problems. Well, sometimes we say, well, they've got problems, we just can't see them. Does that really help? Does that really help the struggle in my heart to say, well, their happiness is only on the outside. On the inside, they're really miserable. That doesn't help them. It doesn't help me deal with what I'm struggling with, criticize them and put them down. But Asaph looks at him and he says, I can see that they are wicked. I can see that they blaspheme God. They're prideful and they're arrogant. And they're so violent, he says, and they've been dressed in violence. And look at the kind of impact it has on them. Look on Asaph, beginning in verse 13. He says, surely in vain I have kept my heart pure and washed my hands in innocence. What good has it done me to be faithful to God? It hasn't done any good. I've been struggling and I've been fighting with myself and I've been denying myself, trying to live a good life, trying to be pure in heart. God is good to those who are of a pure heart, verse 1. I've been trying to live a pure heart and I have innocent hands. My hands have shed blood and so forth. And what good is it? What good is it to live a Christian life? Have you ever found yourself asking yourself that question? What good is it? If the wicked prosper and I'm suffering, why don't I just go live a prosperous life? Be wicked. Because they're living a good life. In verse 14, Asaph continues, for I have been stricken all day long and chastened every morning. God is punishing me, he says. He seems to suggest. Not just that he's suffering, but he suggests that God is even doing it himself. And in verse 15 he says, if I had said I would speak thus, behold, I would have betrayed the innocent generation of your children. And when I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome at my sight. To hear his frustration and his confusion coming out there in verse 16, Asaph says, I sat down and I pondered this, and I am perplexed. How can God be good? How can God be love? How can God be holy? And the wicked that I see around me, they prosper. Things are going great with them. And the temptation comes in that form for Asaph. Terror.